Thanks a lot for the organizers for the invitation. Too loud. Okay, I will talk about market delay and G-expectation. So this is a recent work with my PhD student from Hebrew University. So I will start with a small introduction and then I will present more explicitly the setup we considered. So market delay, let's say in the discrete setup, suppose you have discrete setup. One up to n, this is trading times. And for simplicity, we assume that there is one stock, okay? K belong in this set, and no interest rate, okay? So you use the savings account, but there is no interest rate. So basically, what's the market delay? Let's call it H delay. It means that if you give an order to buy beta K stocks at time K, the order will be executed only in time K plus H. So how the portfolio value is evolved, the dynamics of the portfolio value. Now, we will see that it's similar to a delayed information, but here, a priori, there is no delayed information. So at time K, you observe all the stock price until time K. So beta K is measurable with respect to filtration generated by SK. Okay, but the number of stocks that you buy, it will be executed only in time K plus H. So dynamics of the portfolio value . So you start with some initial capital. Yeah, this is given initial capital. And then ZK plus 1 will be ZPK. Now there is no interest rate for simplicity, but you can extend it for interest rate, but it's not makes too much difference for the result. And here, so at time K, the order executed, the order from time K minus H. So beta K minus H SK. This is the account, the cash account. And for simplicity, we will require that at maturity, you liquidate your portfolio. So we require that beta at time n minus h, sorry, not beta, sum of the orders from n minus h, yeah, because time n minus h, this is the last time it counts because the order in time n minus h will be executed at time n, you require this is zero. Okay, so this is mean liquidation of portfolio. So in this case, I mean, ZPK is not exactly the portfolio value at time K, okay, because you have stocks, but ZP at the maturity, and here I confuse, this should be capital N, okay? This should be capital N. So ZPN is the portfolio value. And in brackets, portfolio liquidated. Stock position is zero. Okay, so again, ZPK is not exactly the portfolio value time K, but we will deal with aging of European options, so we care only about maturity date. Okay, so basically what we want to do with this kind of dynamics, and if we do, so if just one remark, technical remark, and maybe I will pass to a setup that is more comfortable. So if we define gamma k sum beta I from 0 to k minus h, yeah, so this is the number of stocks that we bought up to time k minus h. Okay, so this is measurable fk minus h. And by using integration by parts, we can show that Zpn is the initial portfolio value plus sum n minus h gamma I okay, and so this formula is more, let's say, intuitively clear. This sometimes as you can consider as delay of information. So, I mean, what I'm trying to say is that these two formulation are equivalent. You have partial sums, yeah, and just the gamma I is measurable with respect to fi minus h. Okay, so. So this setup, if you do just technical integration by parts, market delay can be seen as no delay, but delay of information. So time I, you say, you can consider other formulation when time I, you buy, you have gamma I stocks, but the number of stocks, the decision of how much stocks to have, you have, you decide based on delayed information. Okay, so this is, and H is the information. So, what we want to do, we want to study super replication. Okay, so. Okay, super replication of European options. And so in continuous time, let's say in Black-Scholes model, this formulation is problematic. I mean, you can naive formulation in Black-Scholes model or any other reasonable model, you can say, okay, epsilon is the delay, and you want to define, let's say for call option, you want to define minimum x, such that there exists gamma. And let's take, in order not to go into how to define stochastic integral, let's say gamma is just piecewise constant or simple strategy, yeah, what's called simple strategy. But gamma t is measurable with respect to Brownian motion up to time t minus epsilon. Yeah, such that integral gamma t dst, and here again, here the integral is clear, is just partial sums, or even let's say Bachelier model, okay. Bigger than, so I did not show it formally, but I think that the super hedging price will be here buy and hold. I didn't prove it formally, but I think this will be too expensive. Okay, so I mean, you just need, let's say, if F is a call option, you just need, even buy and hold, it's not working, because let's say if you want to buy the stock, the order will be executed only after time epsilon, and the stock can fluctuate enough, so I think it will be infinity, okay? If you start with zero stocks. Yeah, I mean, buy and hold won't work here because, again, let's say you want to have a call option. You want to buy stocks like for how you do with transaction costs. You want to buy stocks at the beginning, but the order will be executed only after some time, so the stock, you don't know the price. Even if you take, again, I didn't prove it formally, but I think it should be true. Even if you take double strategy, if you allow double strategies, like in the transaction cost case, you still get infinity, okay? You cannot, even if you allow double strategies, I don't think you can create an arbitrage if you have a delay. So our approach is to scale the delay, okay? So this is, so super replication in a naive formulation, in continuous model, and also, I think every reasonable model in the sense that it has what's called conditional full support, even if the model is not a martingale model, with delay, probably super hedging price will be, with a fixed delay epsilon, super hedging price will go to infinity. Okay, for put option, no. For put option, it will go to the strike price, but for call option or any other reasonable option, it should go to infinity. So what we want to do, we want to scale the delay. So somehow to take the delay going to zero. And here we consider the, let's say, approximation of geometric Brownian motion in the sense that we consider n-step binomial market. Okay, we consider approximation, binomial approximations of Black-Scholes model. So basically we take interval 0, 1, divide it into n pieces. And the stock price at time k1 is equal to a geometrical sigma is volatility. And xi are plus minus 1. Okay, and now how we scale the delay? We say that in the nth step market, so h is fixed. In the nth step market, the delay is h period of times. So, but if you put it on the time scale, on the same time scale, it means that the delay is actually h dividing by n, okay? I mean, if you put it on this time scale, the delay is going to zero, okay? So you have a fixed delay of, let's say, three period of times, but in terms of time on the continuous interval, we have three dividing by n. And then you can say, you can formulate the superhedging price. So I use this board. So super hedging price. Sorry? Okay, I put it. All right. Too late to change that the video is recorded, yeah? Okay, so super hedging price. Let's say you have a payoff. You can consider here any even path dependent payoff. Okay, so you can, but for simplicity, let's say that you have just for the ease of formulation, let's say that the payoff depends just on the stock price at maturity. But again, you can consider all the function of all the paths, continuous function of all the paths, and you define super hedging price, okay, as minimal initial capital such that there exists portfolio that the PN S. Okay, for any node on the tree. I mean, I'm not writing almost surely for any node on the tree. And here we understand that it's delay with h periods of time. So the main result, and also the only one, says the following. So, okay, before I will just write some preparation, what's a G expectation. Okay, so I mean, if the delay is zero, h is zero, so we're supposed to converge to the Black-Scholes price. When h is not zero, you converge to something bigger. So I just will recall what's the G expectation. Okay, suppose you have two numbers, one dimensional, very simple setup. Okay, so G expectation means that take supremum over all volatilities, take, let's say, adapted to some Brownian filtration, and expectation with respect to Wiener measure. This is a Wiener measure. Yeah, so you have some Wiener probability space. Here you take the same function f, but you allow yourself to change the volatility. So basically, E sigma t dwt okay. This is this can be shown, this is the same. Yeah, I mean, here you restrict yourself to adapted controls, adapted to Brownian motion control, but by randomization you can say that this is the same as taking supremum over all continuous martingales, such that the quadratic variation has a derivative almost surely, and derivative is from these two values. And you just take the expectation, whatever, where the martingale is defined, the expectation with respect to this measure, and here you take a zero EMT minus MT dividing. So M1, okay. And again, if it's path dependent, you can extend the definition just to consider all the paths, not just integral from 0 to 1, but consider all the paths. So this is the G expectation. The theorem says that if we go back to our super replication prices, they converge to G expectation, okay, supremum sigma between zero and the volatility 1 plus h. Yeah, well, h, this is the time of periods of delay and the payoff. Okay. F as zero. Maybe I will write it down. Sigma TWT minus sigma squared DT. Okay. So this is the main result, that if you scale, the super hedging price is reasonable, and how expensive it is. So it's given in terms of G expectation. So if the payoff is convex, what you usually have, like put option, call option, or if you consider path dependent, even look back option, then of course you will take the high volatility. So just a remark for convex payoff. The super hedging price is equal to the Black-Scholes price converge. The super hedging prices converge to the Black-Scholes price with increased volatility. And how it increases, it depends on how much time of periods of delay you have. Okay, so this is a, this is the main and the only result so far. So I mean, how much time I have?
10 minutes.
Okay, 10 minutes. So I just will say one interesting question that I mean we don't know what to do there, and maybe 5 minutes just explain how you get this increased volatility is really in 5 minutes, and that's it. Okay, so one question. This is not exactly, but similar to Leland's strategy and also stuff that Masaki did. So a question is, let's say for convex payoff, for co-option, how to use delta hedging, for the increased volatility, for sigma bar, to get good hedges. Not clear what's good, I mean, if it's super hedging or almost super hedging, not clear, to get good hedges for the original problem. Okay. So this is something that not clear to me. Converge to some increased volatility. So there you have good formulas, at least for call option, how to use it for the delayed market. Okay. Anyway, maybe a few words about the proof. So, few words about it. And really few words, not too much. So, the first step is to derive somehow a duality result for the superhedging price. Now, when I wrote, I wasn't aware, later I found a more general result by, Teichmann, Krista, and Ian Klein, but when I wrote, I was not aware, and also in the paper I submitted, I don't cite them, okay, because I was not aware of this. But at least for the discrete case, duality is quite simple. It's linear programming. Okay, so the formulation of the problem, you get duality for a general. Like if you have a finite sample space, for a finite sample space, this is just simple linear programming. And because I won't go into details, but I mean, you can just write it as a tree and formulate the problem as linear constraints, okay, everything linear. And what you get is that a general result, a duality result, that the superhedging price, let's say if you have just the general case. You have n periods of time, h times of delay. Okay, and suppose you have one stock which lives on a finite probability space. So you get you want to superhedge a claim with payoff x, okay, claim. So you get that this is supremum over all measures In a minute, we will specify what are the measures. Expected value of the claim, where P is not a Martingale measure, as for delay zero. P is measure that if you take the difference of the stock and project it on, a priori, what do you know up to time k, if you consider delay information or if you consider trading with delay. But anyway, you project it to here, you should get zero for any k bigger than h. Okay. This is, and I think in general I saw this kind of result in the paper, but in a discrete case, I mean, you get this quite simple for a like linear programming duality. Okay, so if h is zero, then it's just Martingale measure. If h is not zero, it gives you more space. So just, and I will finish just to explain the intuition, let's say in a geometric Brownian motion, in the binomial cases, but easier to think as the Bachelier version. Okay, so what's going on in the binomial models? Bachelier version. Yeah, so let's say the stock is a random walk. Yeah, not geometrical one, just. So basically, what this condition means, it means that you consider measures that the increment, if you project it to fk minus h, is zero. Okay, c is plus minus one. So before that, without delay, you have only one measure. You should go always with probability half and half. Here you have more freedom. Here, and how you, let's say, how you exploit this freedom to converge to a higher volatility. Okay, this is just a simple intuition how you get the volatility sigma bar. Okay, so what you will do, let's say, example with delay one period. Okay. Example with one period delay. So you know that you xk plus 1 fk minus 1 should be equal to 0. And you want to say, you want to converge to the highest volatility you can. Use one more black one. All right. Yeah? Okay. Now I'm confused what I used, this one. Okay, I will use the blackboard from the left. Okay, so how you converge to high volatility? So you start with zero, okay? And then you take with probability half, you go one and minus one. And then if you went minus one, you continue to go minus one. And if you went one, you continue to go one, okay? So far, no condition is not true. Now you need to mix them again to have that if you project to two times before you get zero. So now you again, you take minus one with probability half and one with probability half. Okay, and the same here. And here again, if you went minus one, you continue to go minus one. If you went one, you continue to go one. The same is here. So you can see that this kind of choice of a measure will satisfy your condition, and you converge to a higher volatility, and the volatility will be sigma square root of 2. Okay, and you can extend it to more periods of time. And how much time I have left? Okay, so that's how you converge to a high volatility. Just one last picture how you converge, let's say, to a zero volatility if you want, if you have a concave payoff and you want to converge to low volatility. So you do the opposite, okay? So you start with zero, you go one and minus one, and then you go here one, here minus one. And now again you split half. Okay, and the same here. So here you will converge to zero volatility. And if you do some kind of a mixing of these two, yeah, this is in the Bachelier model, in the geometric it's more technical, but the idea is the same. If you do a mixing of them, you can converge to any reasonable volatility between these two bounds. Reasonable, I mean it should be regular, but it's dense, so it's okay. The harder thing, at least mathematically, was to show that you cannot converge to something larger. Okay, I won't bother you with the details, but this was a bit harder proof to show that you can, you cannot get something, no matter what you do, you cannot get some volatility, even locally, bigger than sigma bar. So this is finishes my talk. Thanks a lot.
Time for questions and comments, and we should use the microphone.
Jan, do you need any regularity of the function f?
So the measures converge to these measures you don't need, but if you want that the payoff will converge, you need that f is continuous. Yeah, so you have the convergence of measures, so you want to deduce that the expectation converges, you need something on the f, like continuous. Not Lipschitz, but continuous map.
And can you allow for path dependence of f?
Yeah, you can, but it should be dependent continuously on the path.
Super replication is definitely a very strong requirement. But the obvious question is, when you do quantile hedging, when you do utility indifference pricing, What do you get in this case?
I have nothing in this direction. Only thing, yeah, I saw some works of Zhang, but I have nothing. I have just, if you scale the delay to zero in specific way, what are the super edging prices? I mean, with this kind of formulation, if you scale the delay, when you do utility, probably you don't get some liquidity premium. If you keep the delay fixed and ask what is the utility in the Black-Scholes model, I have no idea.
Question, is it important to have a structure, a binomial tree structure for the approximation?
A what? A binomial?
The binomial tree approximation. The binomial tree approximation, is it important? If I replace the xi defined on the discrete time by some other random variables.
Yeah.
Does the approximation, does the limit still hold?
Let's say you take xi with zero expectation, second moment one.
Yeah, for example.
No, yeah. Yeah. I didn't try for this one, but we have some works on fixed transaction cost and proportional transaction cost, and there surprisingly it does change. So it was we didn't wrote it anywhere, but if you take some other approximation of binomial models with the same scaled, for instance, transaction cost, you get other limit. For the delay, I'm not sure. I didn't check. For the delay, I'm not sure.
Maybe I could also speak without the microphone.
No, it's not. It's because of the video.
I sign an agreement.
Okay. So you have this sort of scaling limit of your super replication prices. I was wondering, could you comment more on the questions that you put there?
Yeah.
What the hatching implications would be for the models of the sequence?
Yeah. If f is convex, even if it's convex, if it's path dependent but convex, so the supremum in this volatility problem attained when you take the highest volatility. That's kind of Jensen inequality. So let's say for call option, you get that if you start with binomial models with volatility sigma, you converge to the Black-Scholes sprites with bigger volatility, sigma bar.
This would mean basically in your picture that you would do two-step things and you would...
Yeah, this is like the worst probability measures that you get for a convex payoff. But the question is how to use, let's say you want to super hedge or you want to in the binomial model for a large n to somehow go near the claim. Can you use the explicit formulas for the delta hedging in the Black-Scholes model to get some kind of portfolio strategy in the binomial models for the original problem? Sometimes it's done with transaction cost. Sometimes with transaction cost you have the same case, you converge to higher volatility, and then you can use the delta hedging for higher volatility to get a good portfolio for the original problem with transaction cost. It's like this. So I was saying whether you have this kind of similarity here for the delay. Okay.
Any more questions? Okay, so then let us thank Yang Yin for the talk.